Good evening. My name is Mary Jo Kane, and I'm the director of the Tucker Center for Research on Girls and Women in Sport, and I want to welcome you all to the University of Minnesota. Before the presentation begins tonight, and I hand over the formal duties to Nicole Lavoie, who is the Tucker Center Associate Director, I would like to formally and publicly acknowledge what happened yesterday at Virginia Tech. For those of us who live or work on college campuses, such an unspeakable tragedy has a special impact. So I would like to pay tribute to those who died, to their friends and to their families, whose lives are forever altered, and also to pay tribute and to offer our support and our prayers to the Virginia Tech community for their profound and everlasting grief. If you would please all rise for a moment of silence. Thank you very much. It is my great pleasure and honor to introduce to you Dr. Nicole Lavoie.
Good evening. I'm Nicole Lavoie, and as the Associate Director of the Tucker Center for Research on Girls and Women in Sport, it's my pleasure to welcome you to our Spring Distinguished Lecture Series. Thank you all for coming this evening. I just want to remind you, before we get started, if everyone could please turn off and silence cell phones. I know sometimes I forget, so just wanted to remind everyone. As you may know, the Tucker Center has a threefold mission to conduct research on the impact of sport and physical activity in the lives of girls and women. We also provide first-rate educational opportunities for students, and we also engage in community outreach and public service. Our Distinguished Lecture Series allows us to bring all parts of that mission together by creating a forum that allows the best and the brightest to share their insights and knowledge on various aspects of women's sports, and tonight's panel is no exception. However, before I frame tonight's panel and introduce our distinguished panel members, our spring lecture is particularly special in that we award the Edie Mueller Park and Recreation Memorial Award. Edie Mueller, matriculated to the University of Minnesota in the fall of 1979 and was a park and recreation major during the early 1980s until her untimely death in May of 1982. Her parents, Mike and Van Mueller, could not be here tonight, but Edie's sister, Carrie Fritzy, where are you, Carrie? Over there, is representing the family. The Mueller family, in collaboration with the College of Education and Human Development, have established a fitting tribute to the vitality of their daughter's life. This award encourages participation and enthusiasm of undergraduate students pursuing majors in recreation, park, and leisure studies to further their involvement and deepen their commitment to this area. This year's winner is Carrie Phillips. So Carrie, can you please join me up here today? Carrie Phillips, an undergraduate student in the School of Kinesiology, is not only this year's Edie Mueller winner, she was awarded the prestigious 2007 President's Student Leadership and Service Award, which honors exceptional leadership and service to the university and the surrounding communities. I got to talk to Carrie a little bit before the lecture, and also from reading Carrie's application materials, one thing is clear. Carrie is a leader, and a busy one at that. One of her professors stated, "She lights up the classroom with her energy and intellect, asking probing questions, stirring up discussion, coaxing even the shy or reticent students into spirited interaction." Carrie is involved in many university and community service activities. She works not only at the local level with the Boy Scouts and Girl Scouts and the Boys and Girls Clubs, and I'm not sure you don't work with all youth in the Twin Cities area, but is involved in professional organizations in order to learn how to be most effective in enacting best practices for parks and recreation agencies. Carrie has taken on projects that put her in touch with issues she cares deeply about, such as adolescent obesity and working with youth on improving health and wellness. Carrie Phillips not only believes in the power of good leadership, but she also lives her belief by using her talents to truly make a difference in the lives of children and their families. She focuses her efforts to reach families and children where they are, at the community level, in the field of recreation, where playing and learning converge in healthy and productive ways. For all that she does, Carrie truly is the epitome of Edith Mueller, with her positive attitude and passion for providing quality recreation programs that enhance the self-worth of young and old alike. Please join me in congratulating Carrie Phillips.
I just wanted to take a second to thank the Mueller family for establishing the scholarship. For me, it's much needed, and I do really appreciate it. I also wanted to thank my family. Going back to school and as adults can be a little difficult, and my husband and children have been a great support. And then lastly, a few of my professors are here. I'd like to thank them as well for their encouragement that kept me going as well. Cora Soutley and Harvey Feldman, and if Dr. Russell's here as well, thank you for your support.
I also want to acknowledge members of the Tucker's team for their assistance tonight. Kim Roszewski, Katie Anderson, and Chelsea Rod, I believe, are up in the back, and especially our program associates, Aaron Becker and Jonathan Sweet, for all the great work they do behind the scenes to make this event a success. So let's give them a little round of applause. And I want to remind everybody tonight, that following the panel and the question and answer session, there will be refreshments and a chance for further dialogue in the reception area outside the auditorium. And for the students in the back, you can come on in and fill in. And now to the main event, what has turned out to be a very timely and relevant topic, sex versus athletic competence. Exploring competing narratives in marketing and promoting women's sports. Media scholars have repeatedly documented the unequal and marginalizing ways female athletes are portrayed, marketed, and promoted in all types of media. However, there's been little empirical evidence regarding how such marketing strategies for women's sports are actually developed, how sport consumers perceive and interpret such images of athletic females, and whether these interpretations influence consumer behavior, such as watching or attending a sporting event. Tonight, these high-profile panelists will examine differing philosophies and strategies surrounding the various ways in which collegiate and professional women's sports are marketed and promoted, as well as the effectiveness of those strategies in light of innovative research being conducted at the Tucker Center. I am now honored to introduce our panelists and invite them one by one on stage. Please hold your applause until all the panelists have been introduced. Our first panelist, who will be sitting closest to me, is Kristin Bernert. Bernert is a native of Stowe, Ohio, and received her BA from Siena College and her master's from Ohio State, and just completed her first season as Vice President of WNBA Team Business Development. She is responsible for growth in all areas of team business operations, but primarily ticket sales and sponsorships for all 14 WNBA teams. Before joining the WNBA League office, she served as Vice President of Operations for the Detroit Shock, worked in corporate marketing department for the Cleveland Indians, and has been in athletics administration at The Ohio State University, I just sneak that in, and Bowling Green State University. Thank you, Kristin. Our second panelist, Regina Sullivan, as many of you know, is the Senior Associate Athletics Director here at the University of Minnesota. She earned her undergraduate degree in psychology from Yale and since has worked in athletic administration for the past 17 years. Sullivan has worked for a variety of high-level organizations and programs of women's sports, including the Women's Sport Foundation and the Women's Basketball and Volleyball Coaches Associations, in addition to working in athletic administration at UC San Diego, the University of Texas, and the University of Tennessee. Sullivan is a leader, advocate, and pioneer in women's intercollegiate athletics. Welcome, Regina. Our third panelist, Professor Mary Jo Kane, whom you met earlier, is the director of the Tucker Center for Research on Girls and Women in Sport. She also serves as the director of the School of Kinesiology in the New College of New College of Education and Human Development. Professor Kane was recently elected by her peers as a fellow in the American Academy of Kinesiology, the highest honor in her field. In 2004, Professor Kane received the Scholar of the Year Award from the Women's Sport Foundation. This award is given to individuals who make significant research contributions in the areas of women's sports and physical activity. Professor Kane is an expert on the passage, implementation, and impact of Title IX, and is an internationally recognized scholar who has published extensively on the media's stereotypic treatment of female athletes. Professor Kane. Our fourth and final panelist, Heather Maxwell, is currently a research assistant in the Tucker Center and doctoral student in sport management in the School of Kinesiology here at the University of Minnesota. Maxwell, a native of Champaign, Illinois, earned her undergraduate degree from the University of Indianapolis and a master's degree in applied psychology from the University of Notre Dame. During her 5 years at Notre Dame, she served as the director of marketing and operations for the women's basketball team, which enjoyed a 300% increase in season ticket holders during her tenure. She has been instrumental in the cutting-edge research project you will hear about tonight that examines how images of female athletes affect fan interest. Please help me give a warm welcome to our panelists. Without further ado, Kristin, take it away.
So I shouldn't start it off with an OH. It's a quick way to endear the audience, which I'm very good at. So I guess my PowerPoint won't work because of that joke. First of all, really want to thank Mary Jo and Heather for inviting me in the Tucker Center, and just on behalf of the WNBA, I really want to thank you for being a voice and a leader in our game and in women's sports in general. And just was really happy to wake up the other day and read the New York Daily News and see some great quotes from you, Mary Jo, and just really thank you for being a voice and being a leader. It means a lot. Really wanted to speak with all of you today about hopefully what we find in the next couple of years, which is the complete reemergence of a brand, which is the WNBA. And we'll focus on three different things. First is how we got to reinventing our brand and reinventing ourselves. Number two is what our brand position is right now. And then number three is what we do to support that. Across the board, across the league, through the different avenues that we have. So I'll just move on without the PowerPoint. Good at improv. Anyway, so what we did. Okay.
Sorry, I didn't know
you were starting.
There you go.
Very nice.
Way to go.
Thank you.
Way to go, Jonathan.
Once again, the academics putting the yo-yos first, so they look smarter at the end. It's fantastic. So what we did is, Donna Orender took over in 2005 as the president of the WNBA, and it became very clear to her that we really needed to look at our brand and what we were projecting to the public and what it meant. And in something that she did, she hired a guy by the name of Eric Arnson, and Eric works for a company called Originate Now. But Eric was a part of the Gatorade brand renaissance. And I don't know if you've ever read the book on Gatorade, but their story is one of the best sports marketing stories out there in terms of brand. And what Gatorade did was they found that they were probably trying to be all things to all people at one point. They were just trying to put units on the shelves just like Pepsi and Coke and trying to compete with them. And what they did was they took a step back and they said, you know what, we can't be all things to all people. And we need to define who our core customer is. And they did a lot of research. They did some segmentation research. What they found was that their core customer is the athlete. And that doesn't mean it's the elite athlete. It means it's the weekend warrior, which I try to be and end up getting hurt quite a bit now by doing that. Or just a high school athlete. That's who their target was. So they narrowed their focus and they narrowed the marketing, and that's who they went after. And from there, they were able to broaden their reach by bringing in more of those athletes and building their brand by doing that. So we took the same approach, and in 2005, we did some pretty deep segmentation research, some pretty heavy analysis, a lot of data. Over 1 million data points, 454 pages of data. I mean, these guys over here, these researchers, they know what we're talking about. I don't know, I just look for insights, which we got a lot of good insights out of it. And not only did we want to drive and build into what our brand would be and what our brand position would be, but we also wanted to identify who our segments were. So who are our fans? We went out, it was all users that we surveyed. It was 11,000 users. And we found five different distinct segments. And I'll go into a little bit more about them later. These are their basic demos. You see heavy female in two of the primary segments. And then we go into a little bit more men. We go into the other three segments. But the demos really weren't what we were looking for. What we were looking for was their motivation. Why were they purchasing the WNBA? And for the women supporters, that segment, which is heavy female, it was a lot of women who were looking to support women. Very simple. That's why we named it that way. People who, they may not have been really interested in basketball, but they heard a WNBA team was coming to town, and by golly, they were going to support it. That's the women supporters. So when we also look at marketing, in especially the WNBA, it's always marketing and sales. So we looked at every single segment and said, okay, this is our segment, and what are they currently buying? They're buying season plans, and what's the message to them? And we figured out a question tree to ask for our salespeople on the phone. Looking at what women supporters were interested in and figuring out what their levers were to push. And this is what comes, women, the next generation. And this data point on the end is just what percentage of our fan base women supporters is. Next was team connectors. These are really our season ticket holders. These are our lifeblood. These are our backbone. And as you can see, they're the biggest in size. They're the biggest in dollars, with 33% in size and 39% in revenue. They live and die by the WNBA team. They don't necessarily like other sports. They just really like the WNBA, and in particular, they really like their team. The next one is the hoopsters. These people love basketball. They wanted to see, great players perform. They may, hear that Tamika Catchings is coming in town. They want to see her. They want to see Sue Bird. They want to see all the great players. They may like a particular team. And this is the type that we look and say, okay, this is our message point. And then, okay, it's more of a flex and partial plan, people coming in just to see particular athletes. The next thing we took a look at, next segment, was very interesting to us and very meaningful. And as you see, it's 28% in size and 24% in revenue. And this is where we felt we had the most upside, which is the role model seekers. These are the parents who are looking for positive role models for the kids, and also for the kids who are looking for positive role models. And I love what I do for a living, first of all. And just a brief story, every day is just fantastic. So. I'm sitting in Angela Taylor's office. Is Angela here? Angela's here. I'm sitting in Angela Taylor's office today, and she showed me something that one of her former teammates had written about this whole Don Imus thing. And this former teammate of hers spent the weekend expressing her thoughts and gathering her thoughts on what that meant. And her former teammate ended up being one of my role models when I was growing up, and that was Jennifer Azey. I still laugh that I talked to Jennifer and, consider her, pretty much a coworker, and that she cares that much still and really thinks, at that deep of a level is just why these women are such fantastic role models. So it's really an area where we dug deeper in on. The next one is entertainment enjoyers. These are just people who are looking for something to do. It's an affordable sport. It's something new. You can go into the Target Center and have a fantastic time at an affordable price. These people probably go to 2 to 3 games per year. And that's really all they're going to go to. So we kind of just ignore them unless we're looking at some type of discounting or something or special offers that we put out in advertising. So then we took all of these segments and we said, okay, what do these segments have in common? They have similar motivations. What is the fastball down the middle that is going to be meaningful to all of these segments, and it's also going to resonate to our sponsors and just the general public? So to do that, we built a brand ladder. And first, took a look at what are we about? What do we want to stand for? And you see these terms here: diversity, leadership, mentor, role models. This isn't what we were saying about us. This is what our fans were saying about us. So this is not us thinking about ourselves. So it was great to see that people feel that way about us. Then we looked at our attributes. What do people say we are? Competitive basketball, friendly and welcoming, most affordable pro sport, accessible, entertaining. Again, all great, really positive terms. So ultimately, for our fans, what is that? What is the benefit for our fans when they come to a game? First, it's thrilling. They go in and they have a great time. And next, it's inspiring. And I think, this is a really interesting term, and it just kept on coming back. And it didn't matter the age. It didn't really matter if they had kids or not. For them, it was inspirational in some way. And when you look back at the segments where you have women supporters who might not have had the opportunity to play at the level that these women are playing at, or even pre-Title IX, did not have the opportunity to get college scholarships. This makes a ton of sense that people can come to these games and watch these women at this level and just be inspired by it in so many ways. And then the last one is that across the board, they believed in women. And this didn't mean that this is just women believing in women. It was also men believing in women. And so with these three benefits, and then taking into consideration that these are, we have very active fans. We also found that as well. These are fans, the type of people who are part of the PTA, who are active in their church, who are doers in the community. We came up with the emotion of our brand. And when we think about our brand, we don't think just about our players and our teams. We also think about our fans. And that emotion that we found was that this game inspires people. It inspires confidence. It inspires people. And we really wanted to hone in on that. So what we came up with, which is really important, it's not really important for the general public to know what our brand positioning is or our brand promise or our brand characters and the different terms that we use, which you can read. What's really important for us in developing this brand position to those who believe in women and all those who support believing in women, that WNBA inspires confidence through the game. That term is now something that we live by in the WNBA every day, and everything that we do filters through that compass. So right now I'd like to play a television spot that came out last year, and we still have not previewed our campaign this year, to give you an idea of what that means.
Don't let nobody tell you your love is over. Be every kind.
So honestly, did we accomplish our goal?
Yeah.
I feel like we hit it. And we felt like we did too. I mean, it was not rocket science. I mean, when you meet our players and you meet our coaches and you meet all the people involved in the game and you talk to our fans and you really pay attention, it became very easy. Now, it took a bunch of research and a bunch of money to figure it out, but I feel like we're on the right path. When we think about what we do, I said we look through the same compass, this, you know, to those who believe in women and those who support believing women, the WNBA inspires confidence through the game. Everything that we do filters through that. So just want to highlight a few things here for you. So these are our events. You know, from a league perspective, you see the links do a lot more in the community, and they're a lot more hands-on. We at the league, which is an interesting perspective, is more of a 30,000-foot view, and we create events and platforms that then filter down to the teams or not that are meaningful to our brand and hopefully, it better, drive ticket sales and drive sponsorship. First of all, you know, there's just, you know, three things that I want to pull out. First is the WNBA draft. Who watched the draft a couple weeks ago? So if you watched, hopefully you saw some good news for our Minnesota Lynx. They had it was awesome. We had a couple of trades in the middle of the draft, and the Lynx ended up with the number one pick, Lindsey Harding, which is very exciting, out of Duke. And it's going to be such a great addition. And they got Noel Quinn also and a couple other great players. So very exciting draft for them. Our people are saying they had the best draft. We'll see. You know, it's always when they hit the court is when we see. But that's what everybody's saying. We did something strategic with the draft 2 years ago. And that is we tied it in with the Final Four. And it became a celebration of women's basketball. You know, the WNBA and the NCAA, and you know, Regina, you can probably speak to it, with the WBCA and the WNBA, there's been a partnership throughout. And it's, you know, there's no worry about our athletes leaving early. I mean, there's the Candace Parker thing out there, but come on. You know, she really was not going to leave early. It is a real partnership to work together to grow the game. So we put our draft the day after the national championship game. It allowed media to just stay over an extra night, so we got more coverage. It throughout the weekend, people were talking about the WNBA draft consistently, and it's just, you know, a great place for us to be, for our partners, for our fans. You know, it's a really neat thing that we created and a change that we made. The second thing I wanted to highlight was dads and daughters. Can you see the dads on there? It's probably a bad backdrop. And this goes back to those believing in women. And I think it's going to go back to speak to what Mary Jo, you're going to talk about later on, which is how we appeal to men. I wanted to highlight that because we appeal to men in a different way. We appeal to men and speak to them through their daughters and also speak to them through their mothers. And it's you know, I grew up in Cleveland, and you know, that was our thing, is that, you know, we went to Cavs games and we went to Indians games, and you know, lo and behold, I grow up and my dog's names are Price and Elo, you know, former Cavs backcourt mates. Like those were my heroes. So growing up in Cleveland. So, you know, now it's a special experience for men to be able to take their daughters to a game and be able to look at these athletes and say, you know what, you can do that. You know, it's okay. You can be an athlete. And so that is a platform that we're going to blow out even more this year, you know, leading up to Father's Day, but even throughout the season, to really encourage dads to take their daughters to the game and expose them to such positive role models. The next one is inspiring women. And inspiring women is something that we created in All-Star. At All-Star last year, we had Madeleine Albright as our first keynote speaker, and just honored women in the New York community for all of the inspiring things that they do in the business world and the community. And the teams will be executing that across the league this season as well. So those are just some things that we do at the league level, again, going through our compass of inspiring confidence through the game. We look at it also, so we went through our asset and equity and association. This is how we look at how we drive the brand. Went through some of those. Again, ticket sales and local activation. Talked about some of the strategies that we use to target against our different segments. We create different packages, different programs. Again, speaking back to our brand. messaging and media. You know, we're very strategic about the messages that we put out there. You probably heard Donna Orender, I hope you did, speaking about the Don Imus incident as well. It's very strategic in how we say things and what we say. In addition, our players, you know, we are very active in the community. They are such a big part of who we are and what we do. We make sure we highlight them in every way possible. WNBA Cares is another big platform for us that we drive our message through, which is just our charitable organizations, our player appearances, and all below programming, Be Fit, breast health awareness, different things that we do, again, feeding back into our brand. And then our advertising. You saw our 30-second TV unit. We've also created a dads and daughters spot this season that's just playing in NBA games. Again, you know, going back to speaking to the audience that we're speaking to, we have Ray Allen talking about his relationship with his daughter going to games. The same thing with Chauncey Billups going to shot games in Detroit. And then we also, to help extend our brand, we have a group, which I'm a part of, that works with all the teams, all 13 teams in the WNBA. And we look at sponsorship, ticket sales, fan retention, and customer relationship management, which is more the database and the emails that go out and the direct marketing. And we have account managers that work with every single team. So an account manager is just like an advertising agency where you have an account manager that works with on different brands, helping them build their brands, helping them to share best practices and do things a little bit better. And then we also have a series of workshops that help to get everybody on the same page with our marketing and our brand messaging and the strategies that we used. So just to summarize, the WNBA is at an interesting point. We are very upfront with we are not pleased with where we are. We want to be in more of a position of power and more of a position of growth. And this will be the season that you will see that turnaround. I've said enough. Our attendance will be up. Our sponsors will be up. The energy in behind the brand and the message that we're putting out in the community, you know, is better, more well received than it's ever been before, and you know, we're really looking forward to an exciting 2007 season. And if I leave this podium without saying it, I think that the links would kill me, but we have a special Tucker Center ticket package today that Nicole Smith has out there, and it's actually named after another one of my heroes, Teresa Edwards, which is the tea pack. Nicole, is that what it's called? So please stop by and see Nicole before you leave. And thank you very much, and please support your links this summer.
That PowerPoint glitch happened with Kristin, because that's like my worst nightmare on giving a presentation. I grew up in the New York metropolitan area as a fan of the Knicks, so I watched Willis Reed and Walt Frazier and Dave DeBuscher. So my daughter's name is DeBuscher. No, it's really not. Okay. Good evening, everybody. You know, when you're nervous, they tell you the speaking tip you're supposed to look at in the audience and picture everybody naked. I gotta tell you, some of you don't look so hot. Okay. I think I skipped a slide here. Let's see. All right, there we go. Today's presentation, I'm gonna talk about a little bit about philosophy with Gopher Sports Marketing, some of the data that we use in terms of our attendance and rankings and that kind of stuff, trends and the future. I've been in athletics for 25 years and worked in and around marketing for most of that time, but I don't oversee marketing and I'm not a marketer, so I just wanted to make sure I gave credit to the people who are our Gopher Sports marketing professionals. First and foremost, Deborah Diamond, who's our current assistant director of marketing, who's here. Carrie Canfield is a former marketing coordinator. Natasha Freimark, former director, and Jason LaFrenz is our current director. I talked to each one of them before doing this presentation, and I think they're all fabulous people, and any credit that goes to marketing women's sports programs goes to them and the other people in our marketing program, and certainly not me. Okay, go for marketing philosophies. I think first and foremost, we have a history, a department history and practice of marketing women's sports, primarily because of the separate athletic department structure that we used to have. And I think during that time, it was established that there would be a lot of time and energy and focus spent on women's sports marketing because those were the only sports in that department. So the philosophy back then was that there was a group of programs that we would look at, but actually this is everything I'm going to cover. I'm going to go over here. All right. So there was a group of programs. We call them the Big Six, and that's not to take anything away from the other seven women's sports programs that we have, but they were the ones that were more team-focused and the ones around which we wanted to build a specific fan base. And so that was basketball, volleyball, ice hockey, gymnastics, softball, and soccer. And there was a lot of success around that, and you'll see some of that in the data later, but Minnesota has been a leader both in the Big Ten Conference and nationally in attendance for women's sports, and I think a lot of that was because of the focus and energy that was spent and that was started on when there were separate departments. And I'm happy to say that has continued under the merged department structure, and Mary Jo will probably faint here, but anecdotally, not based on scientific evidence, if you talk to our people in and around the department, we think that we have more full-time marketing staff than other Big Ten conference schools, and that we put a focus on our women's sports that's not the norm for schools in the Big Ten Conference or for other conferences around the country. And I think that's something of which we can be very proud and is something that's Minnesota specific. So I'm happy to say that is who we are today, but I think it is based in the history of the separate women's program. And then the other thing is that we are a window to the university, and our university relations office did a study about a year ago that showed that about 50% of the people who connect with the University of Minnesota do it through our athletics programs. And so I think that speaks volumes about how the University of Minnesota Athletics Department is a window to the university, and that is in our mission statement about the athletics department. And all of our sports have value, so whether it's rowing or track or tennis, even if we don't focus as much resource and energy on marketing those programs, they all have an outreach, and they all have families and friends and supporters who come to those programs and who get an impression about the university and about the athletics program because of that. And I think, again, we're a leader in how we treat our women's programs, and that's something of which we're very proud. We're a college sports department versus the WNBA, which is professional sports and other professional sports opportunities in the Twin Cities, of which there are many. And I think that the things that separate us in the market are program stability. We will never be the University of Minnesota at Los Angeles. And I think that's an important piece. The quality of play. We are a Division I A institution. We fully fund all of our women's programs. I think our goal for each and every one of our programs is to give them the resources to be the best that they can be. And we know that if we're competitive in the Big Ten Conference, we're also going to be competitive nationally. So it's fun to come and watch a softball game or a basketball game or a volleyball match or whatever it is, because our kids play at a very high level. Next thing is amateurism. Much as people try and put us in the professional model category sometimes, because we do talk about money a little bit. We are an educational institution, and we're educationally based, and I think that's important to remember, and I think that's an attraction to people. There's a lot of people that are attracted to the University of Minnesota, and particularly in a state where there's only one Division I institution, and where the University of Minnesota Twin Cities is the flagship institution in the state. So I think that's something that separates us. The next is the alumni base. We have hundreds of thousands of alums in the Twin Cities area who are naturally attracted to the university. And as we know from the research that was done, a lot of them are attracted through the athletics program. So there's a natural base of support there. And finally, accessibility. Our programs are built around being able to see and touch and be up close. You know, in most of our venues, you can reach out sometimes and touch the student athletes and coaches. Are close enough to do that. We hope you're not doing that, but you're close enough to do that, versus in a pro venue where maybe there's some more separations and that kind of thing. And there's a lot of outreach that's really important for us to have that accessibility. So that's a significant piece of it. Role models. As Kristin mentioned, it's very important to us that we are role models in the community. So you know, I think people have an image of women athletes in particular as being very wholesome. They tend to be very strong students academically. They tend to be very good citizens who participate in a lot of community outreach. And they tend to be the type of people that you want as role models for your daughters and for your sons. Sex does not sell with us, I'm happy to say. There was a situation that happened last month where our volleyball team was invited to play in a beach tournament in California this spring, and it was part of the Volleyball Coaches Association initiative to promote volleyball and to get it more in the limelight. So they started this beach tournament, and they partnered with CSTV to get it on TV, and they signed up Speedo as a sponsor. And we have two student-athletes going out to play. And yep, you heard Speedo, and you can just imagine what the uniforms looked like. And if you have ever watched pro beach volleyball, you know what those uniforms look like. And I don't know how they expected us to get University of Minnesota on that little material. I think we would just have been men. Needless to say, I was a little shocked when I saw a copy of what the uniforms were, and so I thought, well, maybe it's just me, 46-year-old, frumpy, you know, not Generation Xer. Let me take a survey. And so I polled our sport administrators in the athletics department, 3 male, 2 women, including myself, and I'm happy to say that everybody had the same reaction I did and say, that's not how we want our student athletes to represent themselves. It's one thing if they're going out on their own in the summer to play in a tournament and they wear whatever kids wear these days. And I hope that style's done by the time my daughter gets to be a teenager. But it was nice to see that there was that kind of support for, you know what, sex doesn't sell. That's not what we're about. We're about the wholesome piece. And so we'll be wearing our regular uniforms, and there'll probably be saying, who are those Midwesterners that we invited out to California to play in this thing? But we can fit Minnesota on them, so. We're interactive. We do a lot of types of activities, and Kristin mentioned some as well for the WNBA, where we try and get involved with the fan base, because that's very important to them. So we'll run kids' clinics. We'll go out and we'll do volunteer activities, PR types of activities, where you know, where it is interactive and you can have that touch, because that's very, very important to our fan base to have that. And, you know, unfortunately, it's not as easy to do that with men's sports these days, college men's sports and professional men's sports, because sometimes they're so high profile that really for the safety and protection of the student athlete, you have to have more distance. But in women's sports, I think we're still at a place where we can do more outreach and interactive type stuff, and it's still a good environment to be in. Our softball team, for example, adopted a family at Christmas last year, and they provided presents and clothes and that type of thing. And that may not be marketing specific, but it's an outreach piece where you know everyone around that family that they touched is going to have something good to say about the University of Minnesota softball program and the University of Minnesota because of that. And then hopefully some of those people might end up coming to a softball game or some other type of game. For the Big Ten women's basketball tournament, they have a pen pal program where they invite all the middle schools from the Indianapolis area where the tournament is based, and they match up a couple schools with each institution, and you do some pen paling back and forth. Our kids write to those kids. We send them some videos, do some different things, some interactive type things, and those things are very, very popular, and they help present the type of image that we're looking for and the type of outreach that we're looking for. And then the last thing is community connection. And every kid that we have, and we have a lot of Minnesotans on our team, comes from a family and a high school and a group of friends that knows who they are and that touches the University of Minnesota in that way. So when you think about the number of athletes that we have and the networks that each one of those individuals have and then the outreach that would be coming back to the university, that's very important in terms of providing the type of image and awareness that we're looking for. We do things like hometown days where we'll pinpoint a certain athlete and we'll invite her whole town to come to the event and celebrate, and that's a way of getting those people to come and buy tickets, but also to celebrate just that personal connection and community connection. We did that for Kelly Roysland on the women's basketball team this year, and I think somebody turned the lights off in Fauston because everybody from that town was here in Williams Arena. And then we have programs like softball or soccer and volleyball, who some of our assistant coaches actually coach club teams in the community, or they do a lot of outreach in the community with club programs in particular. And again, that's another way to touch a whole group of people and network and hopefully have some of those people develop an awareness level and attraction to those specific programs and other programs at the university. Okay, target and niche marketing. It used to be that we would do a lot of direct mail pieces and general ads that, you know, we'd put in the newspaper that weren't really designated toward a specific type of individual, but just sort of a blanket across the board thing. And with direct mail, I think if you get a 2% response, that's considered successful. And that's not really a lot. And so we're starting to get away with that, and knowing our audience is really key to it, as Kristin mentioned, is who are the people that are attracted to come to women's athletics events, and how can we help get them there? And so we've done surveys. We look at the demographics, and Heather did a survey with our women's basketball team last year that showed that, you know, primarily the audience is 41 years old and up. Most of them don't come with kids. There are a lot of single people that come within that group, and so we look at what those specifics are and market to those, and then we look at the groups that we're missing and figure out a way maybe to connect with those people as well. So it's really more of a target and a niche market than a mass appeal type of thing. We used to put ads in the, you know, we might put an ad in the Star Tribune, and whereas nowadays, you know, in talking to Jason, who's our current marketing director, he says, you know, we're going to take a real look at that and see if it's actually worth the money. So we can put an ad in the paper and put a phone number to call in for tickets, and then we can track how many people actually call using that phone number, and as a result of having read that ad, and decide whether or not it was worth it. You know, if you hit 5 people, maybe it's not really worth it, versus if you hit, you know, 100 people or whatever. So I think that's a good way to really sort of narrow down your market and figure out where to put your resources, because it's expensive to advertise in the newspaper. And maybe take advantage more of the natural press that teams get. And for a sport like basketball, they usually get a pregame story, and then a game day story, and a postgame story. And so that's just press that we get for free, which is great. And that usually could be enough to help market in terms of newspaper ads. Now, that may not work as well for a volleyball or a soccer or a softball who don't get that type of press. So that's one more reason for you guys to keep writing letters. So you want to hear more from the newspapers about women's sports. Next thing is the personal connection, and as I mentioned, you know, it's just that interaction and that personal touch that sometimes you don't get, oftentimes you don't get with professional sports, and sometimes you can't get with men's sports because of how high profile they are. But I think that starts with having a customer service base and how you treat your fans. One of our ticket people, Ron Lynch, has been with the program for a long time, and he knows who all the season ticket holders are for volleyball and women's basketball. And, you know, he knows what tickets to set aside because somebody forgot to order, but he knows that order's coming. He knows what people's preferences are. I mean, he really has a handle on who people are, and I think help provides a level of customer service that's really important. We do activities like hoopla for women's basketball to start the season. Volleyball does a season opening event with a clinic and some pizza and bring people in. Hockey team does Skate with the Gophers. There's all kinds of interactive activities that are more along the lines of that personal connection to help promote our programs. We found that when we do giveaways about particular student athletes, those are very popular. So Paula Gentou was a volleyball star for us who graduated a year ago, and when we had Paula Gentou t-shirt day, volleyball attendance went up. And when we've had bobblehead pin day for other sports, attendance goes up because there's that attraction and people want to be interactive with the coaches and the student athletes. And I think another thing that separates women's teams is that they're very appreciative of the support that they do get. And the coaches typically see it as part of their jobs to help promote their programs. They're very, very active in doing that, and they see that as very important. And I think the student athletes do as well. And they're appreciative of the support as opposed to just expecting it to happen. Okay, the next philosophy is about grassroots and youth focus. I mean, these are the people that we really target, the high schools, elementary school kids, the clubs and leagues, Girl Scouts and families. I mean, there's a natural base there of support of people that we think would be supportive of women's sports. And so, you know, as Kristin again mentioned, you know, dads and daughters is important. We have a high school night at every one of for every one of our teams. It's very, very popular. We target elementary school kids as well. Our women's gymnastics program does an excellence in the classroom program where they will give out coupons to every elementary school in the Twin Cities, and they'll have the principal to distribute that to the teachers at the school and say, you design something in your classroom to decide who's going to get these four free tickets to a gymnastics event. So it could be based on academic performance, it could be based on doing an art project of some sort, and somebody comes up with a great idea, whatever that teacher thinks is important for her classroom, and then give them that reward of free tickets to a gymnastics meet. So just some outreach kinds of things. Again, with the clubs, I mentioned some of our coaches who are very heavily involved in that area, and there are the ones who aren't allowed under NCAA rules to coach club teams themselves are very active in doing outreach to reach those kids, because that's a natural connection of the kids who are playing sports for us to go after. We do a lot of activities with the Girl Scouts. I know our softball team, our volleyball team, several other teams will do a clinic with the Girl Scouts and have them come and stay for a game that day and help enjoy that. And there's always a loud buzz when you know there's a bazillion Girl Scouts in the room. So that's a fun day. And targeting families, we'll do four packs where if you buy four tickets, you get four free sodas and four buckets of popcorn and that type of stuff to try and help draw families to come to events and to build loyalty amongst the kids in those families, boys and girls, for future generations. So if you're a young boy or girl and you grew up going to a volleyball match or a gymnastics meet or whatever, then hopefully you'll continue to do that when you get to be an adult. Revenue generation and actual attendance. I'm somebody who it gets a little frustrated when I hear about revenue sports, because none of the women's programs would qualify for revenue sport in the way that most people use that term. But there's a difference between revenue and profit. And the fact of the matter is that all six of those teams that I talked about earlier generate revenue. None of them generates profit, but they all generate revenue. Women's basketball has generated over $1 million in revenue. Now, that isn't enough to cover their expenses at this point in time, but you can't tell me they're not a revenue sport. So I think that's really important to notice. The other thing is that value matters. We don't do a lot of freebie giveaways at the University of Minnesota. As a matter of fact, we're known for having some of the highest ticket prices around. I think that's a good thing, because when you give something away, people take it for granted and they don't think that there's a value associated with it, versus when you put a price tag to it, then people, I think about it more and they think that it does have some value. And we've been able to sustain a base of support with the ticket prices that we do have. And I think that's really a really important message to go along with the price and along with the revenue, which of course we don't mind. There is a place for freebies, though, in exposure. We had an event last year called One Night, One Match, $1 that was around our volleyball team. And normally they play in the pavilion, which seats about 5,000 people, and they move their match over to Williams Arena. And we gave away dollar tickets, and we've gotten 11,000 people. And that's a way to expose twice as many people as we could if we'd hosted in the pavilion to volleyball, and we believe that once you see our team play, you're going to get excited and want to come back. And I think that's a really important way to help promote the sport. We also do crossover promotion where, if we have a women's basketball and volleyball game at the same time, if you buy a ticket for one, you can get into the other, or if hockey's going on across the street, that kind of thing. We do see some crossover among women's sports fans. We don't see as much among men's sports and women's sports, but we do try and take advantage of the proximity of our facilities, and the fact that we have a lot of events going on at one time sometimes, and package those. And then the other thing is just the atmosphere and the enhancers, and it's about the experience. When our women's basketball team went to the Final Four a couple years ago, it was incredible, the buzz around that program. not only during the regular season, but that built up through the postseason. And wherever we went to play in the NCAA tournament, we had the most number of fans, the most visible number of fans. I remember going to New Orleans for the Final Four, and it was just like everywhere you looked was maroon and gold, and people comment. That was the thing that I heard most from the NCAA people, from other teams, from fellow administrators who would say to me, you know, we're pulling for your team. We love your team. We love the buzz that's around your team and your fan base and that type of thing. And that really enhanced Minnesota's reputation because we had that. And I think that's absolutely awesome. Heather talks about the enhancers in her study that she did, and that would be the band and the cheerleaders and halftime promos and that type of thing. And one thing I noticed in there is that it talked about who really paid attention to the cheerleaders, and I think there was maybe 15% of the women in the fan base and like 40% of the men. So if you want to get men to the WNBA there, Chris, then I guess you should look at that. But that isn't something that we would normally focus on. We had an unfortunate but fortunate experience about 5 years ago with our women's basketball team that used to play in the pavilion, which, as I mentioned earlier, seats about 5,000 people, and we had a water pipe freeze and break one night, and so we had to move the game to Williams Arena, and we were doing a promotion called Pack the Pav leading up to that specific game. And you know, so you go from a 5,000 seat venue to a 14,000 seat venue, and people were pretty scared, and the coach at the time said to me, you know, can we call McAllister and Hamlin and Concordia and see if their gyms are available, because I'm not sure anybody's going to show up, you know, or can we tarp the upper level, which you see sometimes in professional arenas, because nobody really had any idea how many people were going to show. And we were pretty nervous beforehand, but you just sort of go with it. Take a deep breath and go with it, and we didn't have a choice anyway about playing in Williams, and we didn't want to move off campus, so we ended up packing the house that night, and it was absolutely awesome and the start of something great, which those of you who are basketball fans, and I know many of you in the audience are, know the rest of that story. Okay, season tickets and single game sales. There's benefits to both, and the good thing about season tickets, if you're a customer, is that you get a price break on the regular ticket price. You get better locations than you would if you walked up. There are some perks, like with our women's basketball season tickets, there were two receptions for fans to come and meet student athletes and the team, and you could enter the arena earlier than other folks. And so those were advantages to buying season tickets. And the good part for us is that we get the revenue, and then we get to count every season ticket holder in the attendance that we announce that night, whether they show up or not. That's kind of the standard practice for how they do it. So those are benefits for us, and those are people that you can rely on that are your base, and you want to build as many of those as possible. We have about 4,000 season ticket holders in women's basketball, about 1,000 in volleyball. And in women's basketball, the arena seats 14,600, and in volleyball, about 5,000. So you can see that there's still a lot of gap there between season ticket holders and total capacity. So it's very important to promote single game attendance as well. And that's where I think our marketing department has been especially good the last few years. So they'll do game day specials, and you can sort of pick and choose the games that you want to go to, and do things to try and really beef up attendance on a specific day. And we really need to keep focusing on that as we build our season ticket base, but fill in, because we want to have as big a crowds as we can. And we've been successful in selling out an ice hockey game this year before the day before the game even happened, which was a first. And in selling out, we've sold out for volleyball, we've sold out for basketball, that type of thing. So it's a balance of both. It's also important to coaches to have bodies in the seats. All of our coaches reference how important it is in the recruiting process, and again, it goes back to Minnesota's reputation of what it's like to come to an event here, and I hear that from other administrators and coaches around our league, from fans and from the coaches in particular, of one of the reasons why prospects want to come to the University of Minnesota is because of the type of atmosphere that we have in Williams Arena, in the pavilion, in Ritter Arena, wherever it might be. And that's where having bodies in the seats is really important, and doing something around that. We had a meeting with our marketing staff and our volleyball coaches a couple weeks ago to talk about the marketing plan for the upcoming year, and that was really one of the topics that we focused on, is how do you balance that revenue generation piece with that attendance piece. And I think we've got a plan that accommodates both. Our target groups, are youth and organizations, companies like Wells Fargo and Federated, that type of thing. And our pricing, I think, is very competitive when you compare it to what it costs to go to a movie, to go to other pro events, that type of thing. Team-centric, that again just references how fans want to be involved with the team and with the coaches, and so we do autograph sessions. It always warms my heart at gymnastics meets when you see the entire length of the pavilion lined up with little girls who are waiting to get autographs from the gymnasts after the meet. We do pre- and post-game clinics. Hometown days, I referenced. Chalk talks are when, if you're a season ticket holder, you can come in and listen to a coach talk about what the game plan is for that day and get an insider view. We have booster clubs that really help promote our women's teams. Terry McFarland and Kathy Mahald are here tonight. They're the presidents right now of the Women's Basketball Booster Club called the Fast Break Club, and they do an absolutely outstanding job. Terry is by far the best booster club president in the history of University of Minnesota, as far as I'm concerned. If you want to look at attendance, and we can brag a little bit, you can see the numbers, and you see some dips and some trends, but we do draw a fairly sizable audience, especially when you relate it to what the averages are for our competition. Our basketball team was first in the conference the last 2 years, 2004-05, and then third this year. I consider it a good thing when somebody bypasses us, because the more teams that are successful, the better, and then that's just more competition for us to try and make ourselves better. You know, gymnastics is third in the conference, 14th nationally, 16th nationally. Hockey, first and first. Wisconsin bypassed us this year. We got to catch them, because we don't want to be second to them in anything. Soccer, we're in the tops in the conference, among the top nationally. Volleyball, absolutely outstanding as well. So that first number is the conference rank, the second number the national rank. If you look at women's basketball attendance here, you just see it broken out. And you look at our competition, you see Tennessee, Connecticut, Texas Tech, New Mexico, and then two teams in the Big Ten that bypassed us this year, Purdue and Michigan State. The Michigan State administrator called me 3 years ago and said, tell me your marketing plan, because we want to do that here at Michigan State. So I gave her the whole thing, and look what happened. They bypassed us. But that's a good thing. It's good for all of us. The more teams that have success, the better. Same thing with volleyball. You see the averages there. And this is who's ahead of us: Hawaii, Nebraska, Wisconsin. The pesky Badgers bypassed us this year, but we're right there in the ballpark, and you can see how that fits. And then I just wanted to show you gymnastics. That's Utah, Alabama, Georgia, Michigan, and Penn State, and show you the potential that's there for a sport like gymnastics that people might not think of off the top of their head. If Utah can do it, we can do it. You look at the pricing for season tickets versus single games. I think the prices are very affordable. That's $195 for basketball, for a chair back, and $48, or for an adult, and $48 for student. So it's a adult and student, and then on the right it's chair back, bench, group for basketball. For everybody else, it's chair back, bench, seniors and students, and then group. And so again, when you think about entertainment opportunities in the Twin Cities, I think we're pretty affordable. Families can afford to come the way they might not be able to go to a Wolves game or a Vikings game or that type of thing. Trends and successes, I think we are going to see some more focusing on those niche markets and the personal touches, and then I think we've done a great job with the others. And then the future, when you think about where women's sports are right now, the NCAA celebrated its 25th year of championships last year. It's been 35 years since Title IX. We're really still in the toddler phase. Men's sports have been around for 100 years and over, just like the WNBA is in its infancy phase versus the NBA, and I think you really need to give it time to grow, and I think it will grow. There's tremendous growth potential there. The long-term revenue, I don't know how to get rid of that little box. But I think we need, as athletics directors, we need not be short-sighted about the long-term revenue potential. Maybe not next year, but 5 years from now, 10 years from now, 20 years from now, you know, we're going to be selling out volleyball, basketball, soccer, gymnastics. I think our soccer team is going to be selling out its stadium within 2 years, seats 1,000 people. And so we need to keep that in mind, and that's a good reason why we need to keep promoting women's sports. Believe it, it's absolutely going to happen. Look at what's happened in the last 5 years, where a women's basketball team has come from 5 years ago, where a volleyball team has come from 5 years ago. It's like hundreds percentage growth, and that's just going to keep happening. Thank you very much.
Well, I wasn't going to share this with you all tonight, but keeping in with the theme of the panel, I grew up in Central Illinois, and I grew up rooting for the Chicago Cubs, and I have a cat, and her name is hasn't won a World Series since. just kidding. The name of the paper that Heather and I are going to share with you tonight is "Exploring Competing Narratives in Marketing and Promoting Women's Sports." Over the last three decades, sport media scholars have consistently uncovered two patterns of representation throughout mainstream media. First, female athletes are significantly underrepresented in terms of amount of coverage. And second, sportswomen are routinely presented in ways that emphasize their femininity and their heterosexuality versus their athletic competence. Now, these trends have been remarkably resilient. They have been discovered in print and broadcast journalism and at different levels of athletic involvement. Whether we look at professional, college, or pro, these patterns are there. So what is the end result of such coverage? Well, what I have argued in the past is that we really have two competing narratives that are going on regarding the impact of such representations. On the one hand, scholars and advocates of women's sports say these images marginalize and trivialize athletic females, and thus play a major role in maintaining women's status as second-class citizens in one of the most powerful social, economic, and political institutions in this country. On the other hand, there are those who cover and promote women's sports who say that a sex sells narrative creates and increases interest in women's sports. And I want to be fair. Many of the people who say this have the best of intentions and are trying to do things that are going to put, if you will, you know, people in the seats. Here's the problem. There is a lack of empirical support for either side of the argument. Neither side of the debate, whether it's competence versus sex sells, has solid empirical evidence for which types of images generate fan support. For example, we have virtually no data on how representations of sportswomen are actually interpreted by consumers, and perhaps more importantly, virtually no data on how the interpretations impact consumers' attitudes overall towards women's sports, as well as their intentions to support women's sporting events, to view, to attend, to buy season tickets. So I want to take just a little side view here to talk about why is it that, and what are the cultural assumptions behind a sex sells narrative? So what are all the cultural assumptions behind these sport media images that we see repeatedly throughout mainstream media? Now, I'm going to give you an example of what happened in 2002 when the WUSA, the Women's Professional Soccer League, was launched to much fanfare, you know, in the wake of the 99 Women's World Cup, where we won, beat China. This was a typical headline, and this is from the Atlanta Journal-Constitution by a writer named Wendy Parker. The title of the article was "Soccer and Sex, Attractive Athletes Sell League." And what Parker argued, and she was being positive in what she was trying to argue, was that the new kid on the block at the time, the WUSA, was relying on an age-old attention-getting formula to promote the new soccer league. But Parker, like countless others before her and since her, rely on a series of key cultural assumptions about a traditional sex sells narrative. First, For women's sports to survive and to thrive, they must attract the real fans, meaning, guess who? Heterosexual males. The second cultural assumption is that the best way to generate male interest in women's sports is to do what? Sexualize women. This ubiquitous narrative can best be summed up in the following formula. Images of sexy feminine sportswomen leads to more social acceptance of women's sports, leads to more fan interest, especially among males, which then leads in turns to more attendance and corporate sponsorship. Now, I want to argue that there are several reasons why a sex sells narrative is problematic, and in fact, I argue it's not only problematic, it's counterintuitive and counterproductive for a number of reasons. First, it ignores and dismisses those most likely to support female athletes, as we've seen tonight, young girls and women, which is your primary fan base. Second, as we've also talked about tonight, many marketing campaigns often promote an all-American, wholesome girl-next-door image. So what I want to argue, if that's the case, is that isn't a wholesome all-American girl-next-door image, by definition, inconsistent with a sex sells narrative? For example, where you have the family's values connection and this whole notion of dads and daughters. Now, I am not naive, and I am not suggesting in any way that men aren't interested in images promoting sex and sexuality. But here is the key distinction that we need to be interested in. When males buy the swimsuit issue of Sports Illustrated, are they interested in being consumers of women's athletic events? Or consuming bodies, women's bodies, as objects of sexual desire? I mean, to me, that's the real issue. My point is that this type of coverage does sell magazines. Nobody's going to argue that. But, and here's the key issue, does it increase ticket sales at women's sporting events or corporate sponsorships? Now, to answer these questions, last fall, the Tucker Center submitted and received a grant from the Women's Sports Foundation to conduct one of the few studies ever in sport literature on what is called audience reception research. This type of research examines not only, and this is what's key, it examines not only the meanings of the media texts, but the audience interpretations and intended practices that they link to those images. It is a basic tenet of reception research that meaning is never just passively transferred from the media to the audiences. The critical issue that we wanted to look at in our study is to examine what viewers do with the images that they see, and again, how they connect that to their interest in women's sports. So, what was the purpose of our study? Well, we designed our study to ask two key questions. First, how do consumers interpret particular media images, and do those interpretations actually influence interest in and respect for women's sports? The other thing that we were interested in, well, let me just do a little side here. For example, what we were really interested in is, do sportswomen have more credibility with respect to consumers or fans when they are portrayed as, for example, serious competent athletes, wholesome girls next door, or sexy babes? The other question that we wanted to ask was, how does one's social role or position in society influence one's interpretation? You don't just walk into a room, you know, as a blank slate. You bring certain assumptions with you based upon who you are in the culture. So what methodology then did we use in order to set this study up? One of the things that I want to share with you in terms of what's been found a lot in previous literature, and I have published a number of these studies, is that there are certain categories of representation. On the one hand, there are a number of images where you see which we call athletic competence, and that's an image where she's on the court, in uniform, in action, a live shot, ranging all the way to the other side where you see increasing images of female athletes in ways that have, I think, alarming parallels to soft pornography, and then several categories of representation in between. So in other words, we at the Tucker Center aren't making up these images. These are images that have been discovered by scholars who look at this research, and then we wanted to take examples of what those categories of representations were, again, not categories that we made up or images that we made up, but that we actually grabbed from mainstream media. So what we have are six categories of representation, and I will explain as I get to each one of these categories with a specific picture what they represent. from athletic competence to ambivalence to the girl next door to what I have talked about in the literature as hyper-heterosexual to sexy babe and then to soft pornography. So what we did was, you know, we have these image or these categories, right, that we can support by findings in the research. And so then we went into the mainstream media and on the internet to say what would be examples or what we're calling exemplars of these categories. So first, this was one of, so we had six images then that we showed our study participants reflecting or exemplifying each one of these categories. So for athletic competence, this was the image that the subjects, or the study participants, we're not supposed to call them subjects anymore, I'm dating myself, the subject participants, because we're all in this together. We showed them an image of Shamiqua Holzclaw, and the reason that this would be coded, obviously, as athletic competence is that she's on court, in uniform, in action. Next is a term that was coined by Duncan and Hasbrook at the University of Wisconsin-Milwaukee, and they said there's a whole category of images that you'll find out in the mainstream media of female athletes that they called ambivalent, an ambivalent portrayal. I think of it more as a mixed message, and what you'll see is that there's something in the image that indicates that you're dealing with a female athlete, but there's another image underneath it, and that has to do with how pretty she is, how feminine she is, how sexy she is. And this is a classic example of an ambivalent portrayal. This is Katie Smith, formerly with the Lynx. And this was a calendar, and to be fair to the WNBA, this was not a calendar that was put out by the WNBA. I can't remember the name of the organization, but they used this calendar to promote the WNBA, and so you had a whole series of WNBA players presented with this ambivalent portrayal, or what Duncan and Hasbrook would call an ambivalent portrayal. Next, we have the girl next door, and this is an image of Michelle Wee that is taken from Sports Illustrated. Now, you could also call this, you know, a little bit, well, you laugh, but it's in Sports Illustrated. It's a very popular image, right? You're a skewed audience, but that's a good thing. We wouldn't have you in our study, though. Anyway, this was from Sports Illustrated, and you know, you could also say that this is an ambivalent portrayal, but there's not a whole lot of images of female athletes out there, folks, so you know, you're sort of limited in what you can choose from. But we classified this as kind of the girl next door image. Next, there's a whole disproportionate number of images of what I call emphasizing the hyper-heterosexual association of who the female athlete is. This is when you have an image of a female athlete who is well-known, and she is clearly identified in the image as being heterosexual. So she's either, you know, shown as being married with her husband, with her children, and I'm not in any way suggesting that there's anything wrong with that. I'm just saying that there's a lot of images of female athletes who are presented in this kind of way. So this was the image that we showed, and this was Mia Hamm. Obviously, we all know who she is. She's with Nomar Garcia Parra. And again, this wasn't taken from a tabloid. This was taken from the ESPN internet talking about Mia Hamm. The next category is called Sexy Babe. And this, too, is taken from Sports Illustrated, the swimsuit issue, and it's Serena Williams. We all know who she is. This is also one of the things that you used to see with the Sports Illustrated swimsuit issue is that female athletes themselves were never in Sports Illustrated swimsuit issue, and now they are more and more and more. Steffi Graf, I think, was one of the first to do so. And then you say, well, okay, but at least, you know, I kind of grew up, when I grew up in Illinois, I grew up Catholic and nuns, and to me, this would be soft pornography. But not today, ladies and gentlemen. this next image is actually bordering between a venial and a mortal sin. Okay, ready? This is, here we go. This is what we call soft pornography. That's Danica Patrick. This, too, is pulled from the internet. I don't know what FHM stands for. Do we remember? I don't remember. But again, if you go onto the internet and type in Danica Patrick, you get these kinds of images. So these were the six images that we showed to the study participants. And so let me just talk a little bit about our research design. We have done a pilot study combining quantitative and qualitative measures using focus groups. And Heather will talk about a little bit more about focus groups, but let me talk some. The other thing we were really interested in our research design was something that is called situated knowledge, which is something that academics complicate. And basically what it's just saying is that where you are situated in the culture, meaning the social role that you occupy, you must take that into consideration when you see how people interpret the images. So we looked at three variables with respect to situated knowledge. First, obviously, we were interested in how old you are and whether or not that is going to influence or may influence how you interpret the image. Second, we obviously were interested in whether you were male or female. And then finally, we looked at level of sport engagement. And here was the argument here, that many people, when they come to sport images, they either come with lots of sport background and interest or very little. And so I don't have time to go into the details, but they had to fill out a scale, and from that we were able to measure what is your past and current sport playing experience, and what is your past and current interest as a consumer of sports. And then based upon their self-identification, they were divided into high level of sport engagement or low level of sport engagement. Let me just talk a little bit about the focus group protocol. I want to emphasize that in all cases, the exemplar images, meaning those six images, were presented to the study participants in a random order. So we were never able to get any sort of response bias as a function of when they saw the images. There were three phases to our protocol. The first was what we called the free association phase, where they just were able to express just, you know, whatever are the first three or four words that pop into your head when you see this image. Write it down on a piece of paper. Do not share it with anybody else in the group, because we wanted these initial reactions to not be biased by a group discussion. So that was a qualitative piece of the study that we had. Phase two, after they saw each one of the six pictures in random order and free associated, they then had to fill out a 1-7 Likert type scale on how each one of the images that they saw made them feel or do one of four things. Again, they did not share this with the other members of the focus group so that they were just able to say how they felt without any sort of bias. We asked them to say, how do each one of these images make you want to read about women's sports, watch women's sports, attend women's sports, buy a season ticket? So you go from, you know, fairly low investment to a very high investment of being engaged in women's sports. And then finally, phase three, where Heather took the people in the focus group in an open dialogue, saying, okay, so, you know, she puts up one of the six images and she says to the group, people in the group, so what did you say? How did it make you feel? And then after that she said, okay, now let's go through your answers on a 1-7 scale of read, watch, attend, buy tickets. And then she just opened it up for discussion. So let me just say, so that's how we did the study. And that's why we did the study. And let me just say in closing that I have been wanting to do this kind of study quite literally for a decade, because if you find anything, you've got something, because nobody's done it. It's enormously labor intensive and time consuming, but it's really important for us to get these data, not just as academics, but in partnership with folks out in the trenches. But you know, I don't have time to even breathe for these days, so I couldn't do the study. But then a dedicated, hardworking, gifted PhD student came along. Ladies and gentlemen, I give you Heather Maxwell.
Thank you, Mary Jo. I really wasn't prepared, panelist, to have a dog joke. But, you know, while your dogs are dreaming about being male athletes, my dog, in fact, is a female boxer. Oh! Just thought I'd let you know about that. So at this time, I'm really excited that you have weathered the storm. You're here. This is a seventh inning stretch, so I would have Joel come up and take me out to the ball game, but You know, I didn't think about it till right now. So I'm really excited to tell you the actual results. Here we're getting to the nitty-gritty, right? We're a results-oriented society. So here we go. We're going to dive right in. A key factor in determining the success of your focus groups is actually who is in your group. Okay, and there's a fancy word we use for this. Our groups were homogeneous. Right, what does that mean? It's a swanky word for it means everyone in that group was about the same. So we had all females in a group, we had all males in a group, and as Mary Jo spoke about earlier, situated knowledge. So these were our three focus groups. 18 to 34 year olds for all the groups. The top group were females, they were all high sport consumers. The next group, all males, high sport consumers, and our final group were all females, low sport consumers. And it's really important that our focus group are homogenous for a couple of reasons, but as you can imagine, people feel less inhibited when they're around others who are like them to share, especially on a topic like this. I mean, be honest, did you see the topic and you saw sex in the title? Is that why you're here? Okay, I pegged you wrong. So moving right along, for phase one of our results, as Mary Jo had mentioned, you know, each focus group, they were told, look at these images, they're randomized, and what does it make you feel? I don't want you to think about it in detail, I just want you to shoot down 2, 3, 4 words about what does this image make you feel. So our first image was athletic competence, and these were the descriptors that came across the three groups. Athletic, focused, talented, and boring. Now you're gonna see a lot of results and you're gonna wonder where did that come from, and we'll elaborate on this later. Boring came from the males, but there's reason, we'll talk about it. The next image, ambivalence, we have Katie Smith here again. Our descriptors, girl next door, funny, silly, and uncomfortable. So what does girl next door mean? A lot of our participants felt she was trying to be everything to everyone. We have mom maybe going out to a dinner, we have your sister next door holding the ball, and then we have, again, maybe a friend or a kid sister, a fun aunt in the corner. Okay, the funny or silly, this should be read as ridiculous. Not by my words. The participants use these words interchangeably. Funny, that's silly, this is ridiculous, okay? Uncomfortable, this is how the participants said they felt when they saw this picture. They, in fact, felt uncomfortable. So, which this was interesting, but not only did they feel uncomfortable, they perceived that Katie Smith felt uncomfortable. Okay, we have some that agree. So, this is key for us to understand this, okay? We'll keep going on this. So we have our all-American girl next door, Michelle Wee. What did they think about Michelle? Thought it was beautiful. They thought it was feminine but athletic, but there was incongruence. So beautiful, they commented on the dress. Some of them thought maybe it was a wedding dress, but it is pretty. They felt like she was beautiful in this picture. They felt the setting was beautiful, a lot of beautiful. Feminine but athletic. When you put the but in between feminine but athletic, what does that mean? Well, it means maybe they don't perceive those two words as one and the same. That's important moving forward. Now, incongruence represents both of the descriptors above. They thought the setting was beautiful, they thought she was beautiful, and they thought this golf club just really didn't fit. It didn't match up. Incongruence. We have our next image of hyper-heterosexual Mia Hamm with Nomar. And the comments were, again, strong and athletic. So now the butt's gone, and that might be significant, but we have this combination again. Pretty, we don't need to say anything more. Uninteresting. The participants, the focus groups, actually had a problem eliciting emotion from this picture. They felt it was neutral. And although it wasn't from a tabloid, they felt maybe it was from a tabloid, a red carpet event. Now our next image, sexy babe. You know, I'm not Catholic, but it's hard. The first descriptor looks like she's having an orgasm. Disgusted, strength, and beauty. Now, the first descriptor, yes, I'll admit it is shocking. And sitting there running the focus groups, you know, you have to be really low-key and just even keel, and someone starts throwing out those words, it's a little difficult. But they honestly, all focus groups, they mention this. So I felt it was important to include. They felt right here in this picture, it looked like Serena was having an orgasm, which led to the second descriptor of especially the females. Low and high sport consuming females were disgusted. And this didn't come out in the male group per se, But for the females, this disgusted them. They felt it wasn't linked to tennis, that maybe they could sell her fashion line, as she's known for designing some of her wardrobe, but definitely not for tennis. And in particular, her open mouth, all groups felt that was really sexually suggestive. One of the groups even mentioned, you know, if she just had her mouth closed, I would be a little bit better with this picture. And Strength and Beauty, again, the two pictures before this, the same typical combination. And our final image, Danica, hot, selling sex, pandering, and unappealing. Hot came up repeatedly with the males. It actually came up with the females as well, as far as recognizing her beauty, and some of them were even envious of her body. Selling sex, all groups mentioned this. They all recognized or stated, Danica Patrick is selling sex in this picture. Pandering, the females felt this image was pandering to a male audience. It wasn't speaking to the females. They felt neglected by this picture. Unappealing. The females in particular felt this image was unappealing. The males, interestingly, actually shifted from saying, this is hot, to when we talked to them about, well, but does this influence your intention to consume women's sport? Not interested. It's unappealing. So again, we get back to the gaze factor, but not translating it into putting them in the seats. So phase two, I have some really swanky graphs here for you. We get to the point where the focus group participants viewed the images independently and rated how each image would influence their intentions to read, watch, attend, or even purchase season tickets. And these are all the groups collapsed into one, okay, overall. So this chart, using scores from all groups combined, represents the influence of each image on reading and watching. And as Mary Jo mentioned before, reading and watching are pretty low investment for time or resource activities. But as this chart shows, the athletic competence on the left and the light blue bar and the light yellow bar and light green bars in the center, all American and hyper-heterosexual images were the most influential. The second graph, again, these are all the groups collapsed. These are for the more high involvement activities of attending a game, actually physically moving your body to a game, or purchasing season tickets. And again, you can see athletic competence, all American and hyper-heterosexual images are still leading the way, despite the investment in time and resources. So this is where it gets interesting. This chart, it represents the actual breakdown for each focus group and how each image influenced their intentions to read. Overall, as expected, you can see the blue bars represent the low sport consuming females, the maroon are the high sport consuming males, and the gold are the high sport consuming females. Overall, you can see the low sport consuming females in blue have rated each image the lowest of all the participants, as you might imagine. In the interest of time, just throughout the rest of the slides, I'm just going to focus on the most influential images. We could go through, and Mary Jo and I will write quite a few papers off of this. So in the interest, I will keep it rolling. But again, notice the two center images, all-American and hyper-heterosexual. For the high sport consumers, this was rated highly. Now, the difference comes when we look at the anchors of this continuum, athletic competence and soft pornography. Looking at athletic competence, the high sport consuming females really favor this image. But again, on the other end, the other anchor on soft pornography, the high sport consuming males really favor the soft pornography for reading. Again, we talked about this in terms of magazines. So here we move along to watching, another low investment. And you see the same patterns persist. Low ratings, a little bit higher actually for the low sport females. But then when you look at the anchors again, for athletic competence, we have a 6 for the high sport consuming females. But then over on the other anchor again, we have the high sport consuming males really favoring soft pornography. Now, attending is included in the high involvement activities. And I want to just give you a second to digest, but the same overall pattern persists. On the anchors, we still have the high sport consuming females rating athletic competence the highest. And on the other anchor, soft pornography rated by the high sport consuming males. Now, the interesting thing that we should note is that on competence, for the high sport consuming males, this is their second most influential image, Competence. So keep that in the memory bank. We'll be coming back to it. And our final chart, as you're charted out, this is represents the influence of each image on purchasing season tickets for women's sport by focus group. And interestingly, if you notice the bars drop, no image that we showed the high sport consuming males significantly influenced their intentions to purchase season tickets for women's sport. Even if you notice clear to the right, on the continuum for soft pornography, the maroon bar has substantially decreased. So once we move that involvement and that investment to actually purchasing a season ticket, soft pornography really wasn't even doing the trick anymore. And in contrast, if you look at the athletic competence for females, they remain consistently strong in favoring athletic competence. So this is my favorite part, phase three. This is where we just got to talk to people and actually have these numbers come to life. When we use words like quantitative and qualitative, what does that mean? Well, quantitative is when they're circling the numbers on a survey. And when we get those back, they're just numbers, right? I don't know why you circled a four, I don't know why you circled a two. But then Mary Jo and I looked at the open discussion, and that brings to life those numbers about why you circled a two. You actually got to explain it. So during phase three, the focus groups participated in open dialogue regarding each image. And again, in the interest of time, I'm going to focus on the three images that really elicited the most response. The first image I will discuss is this image of ambivalence. I know we visited Katie a couple times already. But this image, again, is a portrayal of a female athlete, typically off the court, typically not in action. But with the ball, especially for the WNBA, you know, we know that is associated with the WNBA. At first, using this image, especially having been a practitioner, it makes sense. You know, we can sell that she looks straight. We can sell that she looks like the girl next door. It somewhat speaks to both narratives that we're talking about tonight, right? The evening gown, it might be a stretch, but maybe sex. The other ones, maybe a stretch, but selling competence. What we found in the preliminary results, and keep in mind this is a pilot study, we only have three focus groups, but these results indicate that this image simply equally offends people. And I think that's really important. The following excerpts from the open dialogue should provide a few more insights. I thought it was very funny. I just wanted to laugh. It just felt like they were pandering, and I was embarrassed for her, especially that top picture in the black dress. I was like, oh my God, that is terrible. My questions are, and this woman was angry, why can't you just be a basketball player? Why does she have to be wearing the black dress? To me, it seems like you're trying to make her everything, and she could just be a basketball player, and we could be happy with that. And moving along to the males, she's a bigger lady. They could have done it differently than that. It'd be like having an offensive lineman in football posing without a shirt on, you know? You just don't do that. So you stick to playing on the field and having like action shots on the field. She would probably feel better if she were playing a game versus like posing like a model. So from these excerpts, I think it's obvious that no one felt she chose to be portrayed this way and that they were trying to make her everything to everyone, and resulting in it not being attractive to anyone. The most prominent differences in ratings concerning what images influenced the consumption of women's sport were elicited by the athletic competence and soft pornography images. For the remainder of this presentation, I'm going to focus on the responses to these two images. First, I'll present the excerpts from the open dialogue concerning the soft pornography image. Hot. I would open a magazine and see if there were more pictures, but it would do nothing for me as far as racing or this car. Very hot. Oops. Sorry, I already said that earlier. I hate to say just because she's pretty, but like it might just make you more interested in the sport. You go for that reason to see, but then it might make you more, I don't know if I'd get season tickets, I didn't say that. And the guys break out in laughter. Bring attention to the sport. I still don't think this is bringing attention to the sport. It's just saying, hey, check her out. Use her as a sex object, and not necessarily saying, watch her race. I circled all ones because, again, it was not connected to athletics for me at all. So there wasn't any inclination to even think about reading, watching, or attending sporting events when I see this. So overall, high and low sport-consuming females felt this image of Danica Patrick was disconnected from sport. They recognized your beauty, but they also felt as though the image was pandering to a male audience only, and they really didn't appreciate the negative attention that the image was attracting. In comparison, high sport-consuming males felt this was hot, it was sexy, and they enjoyed gazing upon and consuming her body. But in the end, as their quote reveals, it really didn't influence their intention to actually attend the event or to purchase season tickets. As a matter of fact, an anecdotal side note, one of the participants said, "Yeah, why am I going to go watch Danica Patrick? She doesn't wear that outfit when she races." Enough said. So similar contrasting comments were stated regarding the athletic competence image. And if you remember, that was Shamiqua Holtzclaw driving the lane. I put all sevens just because this motivated me. And it looks passionate and it's athletic. The first word I wrote was accurate, because when I think of an athlete, this is what I think of. If you have the two options, why would you go to the more slow-paced one? And then my second follow-up reaction to that is they tried to make this look like a pretty cool action shot. It looks like maybe it would be exciting, but I know it's not, because I've watched it. For me, it's not. The first thing you know, I just thought sport, athlete, strong. And there was no downplaying of any masculine features. You know, the muscles, her determination. You can almost see, you just can feel like you're right there in the sweat. Yeah, that's what I would want to go see. And I don't know who she was at all. And I was like, I would love to go and watch and see her. And I would love to go and watch that team. Overall, the high sport consuming males could not view women's sport independent of men's sport. Immediately, the males compared women's sport to men's sport and marginalized it, deeming female athletes as inferior to male athletes. But interestingly, when the males were asked in a vacuum of market competitors such as men's sport, would this influence your intention to do these four consumptions we've talked about, they rated it pretty favorably. But it became really clear in the open dialogue that none of the images presented would motivate them to attend women's sport or purchase season tickets when attending a men's sporting option or was an option. And in stark contrast, high sport consuming females identified with the image of Shamiqua Holtzclaw driving. They thought it was accurate and it was motivating. So in conclusion, what are our take home points? About the sex narrative, it does interest males. It does increase at least their intentions to read and watch women's sport. However, in the end, this narrative did not influence their intentions to attend or purchase season tickets. The sex narrative also alienates females who, in fact, as we've heard tonight, are our core audience for women's sport. In contrast, the competence narrative, we saw backlash from males immediately. And without me as the facilitator even mentioning men's sport, there were constant comparisons, constant. And also an interesting note, as we talked about the competence bar for males being second place, remember I told you to tuck that away? The closer the images were to encroaching upon the more masculine sports, such as basketball, the more the males were not interested, and they made these comparisons. Whereas when we spoke of tennis, there were no comparisons between men's tennis and women's tennis. And I think the other interesting note, and Mary Jo and I kind of talked about this, as far as the males, when we looked at the numbers they circled, they were pretty high for competence. But in the open dialogue, we didn't see any backup of these numbers. And we talked about it could have been because there were males in a group and we don't want to show that we're really keen on women's sport, kind of the peer pressure deal we all deal with. The other part of competence narrative is that it increased intentions for consumptions across the board for females. From reading to purchasing season tickets, this was what sold tickets for women. So I leave you with $1 million question, or Mary Jo told me to say the $64,000 question.
I did, and I said, say $64,000, excuse me for interrupting. And when we were going through this, and she said, why $64,000? And I said, never mind.
Hey, when you want to talk about demographics right there. So clearly, marketers need to continue to grow the loyalty of girls and women, as they are our core audience for women's sport. And the preliminary results indicate that women want to see competence. They do not want to see sex. However, this does not mean that we do not want males 18 to 34, as in this case, or any others, to not attend. As a matter of fact, they're a coveted demographic, and we would be ignoring half of our population if we were to say this. But given the results presented, it seems marketing competence motivates females but ignites backlash with males. And similarly, soft pornography offends females but increases males' intentions to consume. Therefore, the $1 million question, and I'm not making any deals tonight. If no image motivated 18 to 34-year-old males to attend women's sporting events, how do marketers increase their interest in attending? Or do we need to? Thank you.
Thank you, panelists. That was very interesting and enlightening, as usual. What we'll do now is we have a question and answer session, and we have two of the Tucker team members with microphones. So what we would ask you to do is to just stand up, find one with the mic, because we are tape recording this, so we want to get your question on for prosperity. And direct your question to one or all the panelists, so state your question quickly and limit yourself to one question so that everybody can ask. So we've got Kim and Chelsea. If we have someone with a question down here in front, Kim.
Quick question for Mary Jo and Heather. Where does race enter your analysis? I was really intrigued, Serena Williams, hyper-heterosexuality, athletic competence. Did your respondents talk about race at all?
Well, hey, Peg, I haven't seen you for... Hey. Well, one of the things that we clearly want to do when we expand this nationwide is to not only include a race narrative, but also to bring people of color into the discussion as part of a focus group. We very purposefully and consciously made sure that we had individual and team sports represented and women of color along with white women. So that was part of the research design. Now, in terms of the results, did you get any race stuff at all in terms of a reaction or a narrative?
You know, to be honest, overall, I think the time that race was most noted, I mean, obviously it was noted when I looked around the room, and saw little diversity, but race was really noted in the responses as far as agency, meaning the athletes, the participants' perception of how in control the athlete was. And I think that's the time it really came up, because most people, while looking at Danica or looking at Michelle Wee, I believe, when they looked at the image, they thought, oh yeah, she would do that. She probably willingly did that. You know, but when they looked at Serena in a more sexual picture, they thought, Danica and Michelle, they thought, no, they wouldn't do that. Look at the blank look on her face. You know, look at the way she's passive. But when we got to Serena, and I don't know if it was race, I don't know if it was her personality, I don't know if they know she's involved in fashion, but they felt like, oh, Serena chose to do that. And it came out in their language of, yeah, no one told Serena to do that. She did it on her own.
Just one little quick follow-up that's not necessarily connected to race, but something that Heather just said. And this is, you know, research is a series of trade-offs, as many of us in the room know, and this is really difficult, is that the ideal in this kind of study would be to have images of female athletes that nobody knows. Because, you know, for example, if you notice those images of Mia Hamm, even though they said that it was the image itself was uninteresting, they were interested in attending, and I think it's because of Mia Hamm, because they know who she is. The problem is there are so few images of female athletes where the athlete isn't well known that you don't have this panoply of images to choose from. And so we were really sort of stuck between a rock and a hard place in terms of having images that people really knew who they were. And I think that very much affected how they responded to the image.
Mary Jo and Heather, congratulations on your study. I have a question regarding how the women portrayed who were athletes. As we know, some sports, and I'm thinking to my experience in Australia where the women's basketball team wears the unitard, and that they're portrayed in a sexual manner, but they're also engaged in athletic competence. And then you have, I believe, the beach volleyball, the way that they're portrayed is in a sexual manner, but it's also in a sense that they're competent. How do you think that they would play into your respondents, or is that future research? Or?
I think that's a great point, especially, you know, you're combining two of the variables we were looking at, and they would be completely, you know, enmeshed. And I think it would be a great future study, especially when it becomes, you know, that's just part of the game, whereas Regina talked about they were able to opt out of it, but, you know, not in beach volleyball and not with the unitard wearing Aussies. So, yeah, I think that's a great future. I think it would cause more of the combination word usage, just kind of going out on a limb there, a more, on one hand, I think this, but on the other hand, you know, confusion, I guess.
I also want to say something about the age group. Just I want to keep in mind, we only looked at 3 of the 8 focus groups that we have set up for this pilot, and I absolutely predict that when we get older males, they will have a very different reaction. And while I'm sitting here, I'm thinking maybe we should have one focus group of males who are not dads and males who are dads of daughters playing sports, because I think that will make a tremendous difference. I mean, I think one of the most important things that we found, again, sort of serendipitous, was Heather's point at the end about how at no point in our study did we ever elicit any comparisons with men's sports, ever. And yet for the males, they, especially when we showed images of basketball, they constantly kept making comparisons. Well, it's an inferior image, it's not, or an inferior sport, it's not the same thing. I don't believe that older males will do that, but that's why we have empiricism.
And, you know, to piggyback on that, as far as the comparisons and moving into these more male-dominated sports, there was, you know, I could have provided a million examples that would have really illustrated these points, but another example of this comparison was made with hockey. Did I show an image of hockey? Not one. But the example came about when, do you remember when the USA team, did anyone go watch the USA women's team and they played a boys' high school team around here? Wow, they were passionate about, that was, in their words, horrible. And the O was just drawn out, horrible. You know, these are the best women's hockey players we have, and they got beat by a high school boys team who maybe have one or two kids that play D1, and maybe no one's going to the pros. It's horrible. And they could not get past this. So talk about a male-dominated sport of hockey, right? Not showing a hockey image at all.
It showed racing.
All right.
I've been a basketball season ticket holder for a number of years, and one of the things that struck me here at the university is the lack of, what seems to me, a lack of a big vocal student section, and I'm wondering if there's been any marketing to the students, what you do for that, and if this study makes you think of some new ideas.
It does, and I'm glad you brought that up, and historically we haven't had a large student section at our women's games, especially compared to our men's games. But if you look around the country, there were some games this year, Duke, North Carolina, a couple in the ACC, where you saw a huge student section cheering for their women's team. And I think we have made efforts to target student populations, working with the Greeks and the fraternities and that type of thing. And we haven't been as successful as we'd like to be. And I think that points to, do you go after the groups that you know you're already successful getting, or do you go after some of the demographics that you're not successful getting? I think the success of other programs around the country shows that we can be successful and maybe need to do some more work there.
Uh,
Regina, this question is for you too, kind of piggybacking on the ticket sales issue. You know, I've been a strong supporter of both men's and women's sports, and then had a child who is small and young and maybe can last through a half a game or so. And correct me if I'm wrong, but the Big Ten developed a new ticket thing where even if you're a week old, you have to purchase a ticket now for kids. Since you're saying that, you know, we're targeting families for certain, has that affected? Because I've heard a lot of people say, all of a sudden now I have to pay for my two-year-old, and now I don't know if I'm going to go because, you know, and if you're earmarking towards families, does that affect ticket sales at all?
Yeah, you know, I went to the Women's Final Four in Cleveland last month, and I had to buy a $140 ticket for my one-year-old, and I was really ticked off. That's an NCAA championship policy. Our policy at the University of Minnesota is if they can sit in your lap, you don't have to buy the ticket, and I think that's an excellent point. It's just simply common sense. So when I get some time, which probably will be about 10 years from now, I'll write a nasty letter to the NCAA, but I couldn't agree with you more.
Okay, if we have time for one more question. Okay. Well, thank you for coming, and let's give our panelists another round of applause. Please join us in the lobby for some refreshments, and if you would like to talk to the panelists further.